Hello, I'm John McGrath. I'm a producer for Flatland at Kansas City PBS, and I'm here to tell you about the amazing new local film right here in Kansas City, the action thriller SCP Overlord, directed by Stephen Hancock.
So SCP Overlord's about an NGO that discovers this cult commune specifically, and that they think that there is some anomalous activity happening. And the NGO is called the SCP Foundation, and to kind of simplify it, they're basically the Men in Black, and they use private military contractors, different types of teams, that are designated for certain type of containment procedures. So if there's like an entity that deals with, you know, that's chemicals, they have an MTF for that, or a mobile task force is what they're called. And in this one, we used actual ones from the website, because it's a big website where people write stories and they're kind of formatted like classified documents. And we used mobile task force units from that website and then adapted it to live action.
Execute.
This is Echo 05 moving to level 2.
Catherine Bigelow she's one of my like favorite directors, specifically because of the grittiness of her films. Like they all have kind of like a documentarian style to it.
Holding, Smurum.
With this, I kind of wanted to use that particular scene as a reference.
Osama!
It was dark, but when you see the actual film set and how they lit it, they actually just had lights everywhere, and then they dimmed it in post. I'm like, oh, that's really cool. I'm going to do that. And that's the only scene that we had for reference when they actually had special operators going out into the field using those type of night vision goggles and doing whatever it is that they're doing on a night mission.
Talk, move to second deck.
I like to emulate somewhat natural ambient light as close as I can do it within reason, and using that particular scene as a reference really did help us, because like the dome lights, how they were edge lit, and you can kind of just see just the shape where they look like ghosts, which was one of the biggest goals that we kind of wanted to achieve in presenting these guys. Yeah, definitely pulled a lot of reference from Zero Dark 30 and Sicario as well.
Don't you f***ing do it.
What we decided to do is, instead of hiring actors and worrying about performance on set, we just kind of had them body act what the lines would be. And the way we did that is that we would read the character name, then we would read the line, and then the talent would just do the body motions. And I would instruct them, like, okay, don't be too animated, just do it how you would do it. And we did a few takes of that. And the reason why we did that is because if we needed to change a line, or if we needed to change the pacing of a scene, we could trim the dialogue and we could adjust it in post. And we could put most of our focus on getting all the shots on the shot list that was needed, because it was like well over 200. And we could also make the shots look cool. Because there's one of the biggest things, like time inhibitors on set, is getting the performances right. And that was one thing that, we can just cut that out. And we know a bunch of very talented voice actors that we could just reach out to and just go from there.
Can you blow it?
No. We need something heavy. I don't want to risk damaging anything inside.
We actually did end up rewriting a few scenes and trimming a lot of dialogue and even adding dialogue just to kind of stretch out the pacing of a scene to make sure everything flowed like extremely well. Surprise, like, because before the original cut was not very good, as most first cuts are, but then after we got everything polished up, most people told me that after they saw it, they said it didn't feel like 30 minutes, and I was like, cool, I succeeded, we're good there.
If at any point, if we're shooting and the effigy falls, don't react to it, just keep moving. We're just gonna keep on doing the shot.
I found this place. It was 3 hours away. It was in Bland, Missouri, which is about 48 minutes southeast of Jefferson City or so. no cell service, nothing. But I called the guy and I was like, hey, we want to shoot a movie on your land. We have to burn something. Is that cool? And he's like, yeah, dude, come on out. I'm like, oh, wow. That was easy. Great.
This is the most important shot. And we have probably the best lighting conditions right now.
And there is nothing out here. We are in the middle of nowhere, which is great. And the crew house was like 10 minutes down the road, which was perfect. You know, I had them set up, you know, granite countertops, hot tub, you know, chill out. Make yourself feel good. You're good. Because most of the people that came out there were all working for free. They all volunteered, which is great. And just this area had literally everything that we needed. Starting in video games and learning how to make films with applications that supplied us with unlimited resources. So we were already used to working with voice talent, and most of the talent that was in the film were people that we've known for 10 plus years from that background. So we were already kind of in our element. We were just applying like, okay, we're just not doing everything ourselves this time. We're just working with real people. But the film itself is, yeah, it's supposed to be represented just as a film with our own unorthodox techniques applied to it.
Gletschke, get up here.
The genre itself is basically like a tactical thriller, like taking cosmic horror and the absurd things that go with that and mixing it with like a military action film. Because I haven't seen anything like that before. That's not a very common thing. And another thing that I pride myself on is trying to get the tactics correct. So we had advisors and everything, because there's so many Hollywood movies that they go out and they make a military film and they botch it because they just roll with it. They don't have advisors or anything. And that really helps because Evan and I did a podcast recently and we were discussing this, and he said, when you're taking the grounded like realism from the tactical side and you combine it with the absurd cosmic horror, like the Lovecraftian, imagery that we try to portray onto the screen, it's perfect contrast. And that's something that I think that a lot of people will come to enjoy with our future projects. For this particular film, we wanted the audience to feel like they were with the team from the start of the operation to the end. And having an ending like that, because we did the same thing with Dollhouse, is just, we like people to use their imaginations for things, but also the reaction that we get from it also makes people want more. So it's definitely something that we like doing, because then it gets people talking. A lot of people start creating their own, you know, their own endings or their own theories with it. And it's really fun for us to kind of see like, all right, let's see what people come up with. Like, what are they going to, let's see if they find, you know, the Easter eggs throughout the film and the other, you know, deeper meanings of certain things that were purposely put there, and see if anyone will go back and rewatch the film and see if there's anything else that could maybe help them, you know, justify their conclusions that they may come to. And having an open-ended ending like that, I think just kind of gets other people's imaginations to go wild. Like, I have received, you know, a few messages from people on Instagram where, you know, when they know, like, from where I came, like, where I started and then where I am now, they said, like, man, you know, you really inspire me to kind of do a lot of things. And one of the biggest things I tell people is, like, never settle, man. Just keep going, you know, just come up with ideas that will get people to just keep talking about your content. And we found that leaving endings open like this is the way to do it. But, and also, you know, just kind of showing everything is really boring, I think, because then it's like, oh, well, here's the ending. There it is. It's done. And then you forget about it, you know, but this way it makes you think. And that's something that we really like to do with our audience, is to really get them going, really get them theorizing, like, where could it go? What happened? What could have happened? Or why did they, you know, go this route rather than another route? And that's something that we find to be extremely important to our storytelling.
We can take it from here.
Roger. Kalinske, bring up the camera. Kalinske, what is it?